discussed FI and bio groups. I want to generalize that a little bit. So yesterday we said WA acted upon by some special arthromorphism group, subgroup of the special arthromorphism group of WA. But that really restricts you to the semicircle case, and I want to do it more generally. So let me say what you do in general. So you have a root vector, or based. And you define W is W0 acting on X, that is now the extended defined by group. So this naturally acts on, let's say, the Euclidean space X tensor by R. And now you have the canonical rejection subgroup. It's a normal subgroup. Rejection in the FE, the FI type of planes. And then we can see that if you put omega is W, not WA, it's isomorphic to X mod Q, where Q is the root letters. So WA has root data. Semi-simple root data. Form delta 0, and then you take the roots, and then roots delta 0, and then you take the dual wake letters delta 0 check, and so this is a finally generated Euclidean group. And this splits again. So again, it splits. So you have that W can be written as WA, acted upon by omega. So that looks very much like what we had, but the difference is that now this finite Euclidean group doesn't act faithfully. So in other words, so with a map, a natural map to special arthromorphisms. And in fact, well, there is, so note, you have a map, natural map, M, from X to, so they define integral linear forms on the co-group letters. So on the dual, which happens to be P, and this extends, so that is a natural map extending the inclusion of the root letters in the weight letters. And so the kernel of M is the center of the FI well. And this FI well group on the center is isomorphic to a finite extended, just like we had yesterday. And so this is WA, a and then the finite part of this omega, which acts favorably, so this omega f is the image of m in E mod Q, and this is really a genuine subgroup of these special automorphisms again, and then everything I said yesterday applies. So we are really, it's no effort to make all the definitions in general for this context, but now is admitting that there can be also some lattice part. All right. I want to introduce, having now already this affine loop datum, I want to introduce, so sigma zero is the root system. Associated to this root datum, that's given the name R. And so if alpha is in this root system, I define Q alpha plus is the product of Vs prime, where S is the simple reflection as alpha. And remember, we had this, I should put the prime on the S. So we had this S prime, which is an affine reflection in the hyperplane, not of alpha, but of the affine group alpha plus 1. And this is not necessarily conjugate in the affine bio group to S, so you may have a different variable, but it doesn't happen often. But in any case, we define Q alpha plus is this, and Q alpha minus is Vs divided by Vs. Right. That's just a piece of notation that I will use. And about this, so recall or note, if S prime is not conjugate in the bio group to S, where S is S alpha, and let's say like that. If S alpha plus 1 is not conjugate in the affine bio group to S alpha, that implies, it's very easy to see that alpha check is even as a functional on X. And in a simple type for sigma zero indecomposable, this happens only for this R is of type that I call CN1, the affine extension of the CN root system, so I can write this in terms of this. Okay, so this lattice CN, and then sigma CN. And the dual lattice is also C. And I'm doing this wrong, I'm sorry. So what I call C and 1, then here is B and here is C. And then the affine diagram for this affine loop diagram is the familiar affine extension, so we have the one special node corresponding to the hyperspecial point we chose, and so you see that there are two of these non-trivial bonds, and that gives you the possibility of having, so here will be the parameter, can I say that so quickly? Yes, so here is the parameter Vs prime. Vs0, Vs1. I will not try to give some notation. I will not use it. But in any case, so you see that there are three classes. And as a result, as a corollary of the Bernstein presentation, we see that the center of this affine Necker algebra associated to some group datum is equal to, we take this algebra A, take the finite biogroup invariants, where A was this lambda delta x, x and x, this commutative circuit. And so this I can write as the regular functions on the orbit space of the action of the biogroup on a torus, a complex torus, where T is T of C is the algebraic torus over C with character letters Z to the number of parameters times x, and we view this as a torus defined over lambda, we look as torus over lambda via, then we have to say how the generators of the ring lambda map to the to functions on the torus, so we map v as n to n v as natural notation for the basis in these letters, comma zero. Okay. Now I want to, view everything that I do relative to this basis. Remember that the real points in the spectrum of this lambda, we call it Q. So this is, let's say, the vector part of the spectrum of lambda. So that was the spectrum of lambda is itself a complex torus. We took only the part where you have positive real values on the parameters. So this was the op space. Of lambda to C, sorry. Such that so if I have some element in here, let's say lambda, then the lambda of one of the simple generators is R plus. So this is the base space, and everything that I'm doing is relative over this base space. If you are familiar with just your Holy Hecker algebra of the split group, then you're used to having all parameters equal, but then still you have this C cross action, so to speak, with which you can move everything. And so in general, I'm happy to allow for unequal parameters. The reason is that this is an important tool, first of all, and second, it shows up in this world of unipotent affine Hecker algebras, this unequal parameter class. And in some sense, our task will be to relate all the Hecker algebras with unequal parameters that we get, to the one with equal parameters, which is associated to the Imagoni-Hecke algebra of the split form. Or, in the case that you have a quasi-split element in the inner class, then you have to modify this a little bit, but that can be easily done. And so then this is also not an equal parameter Hecke algebra, but the gradient affine Hecke algebras can be untwisted, so to speak, and give you equal parameters. So in any case, that is a technical point for a split group, and its inner forms. With all the unipotent types, you will associate unequal parameter Hecke algebras, and you want to bring them in a relation to the Imagoni-Hecke algebra for a reason that will be clear at the end of this lecture, hopefully. Namely, this is the way how to attach Langlands parameters to their representations. So this is why I'm doing this in a little bit complicated way. I want to see everything relative over this place. So for each point in Q, which I will typically indicate by a V, which is a vector of parameter values, so at each S I then have a positive number, I view, so here is this space Q, and then above each I have a torus, which I typically call TV. And this V can vary. Is that clear? And I can also speak of lambda value points in this torus. So there's a lambda value point. That's nothing but just a it's an algebraic function from this base space to this family. Right? So it means for every value of your V in the base space, you get the corresponding point in this fiber, which is just a complex torus with character that is X. But as you vary the base point, this point will vary in an algebraic point defined over lambda. So I will use sometimes this notation, the lambda value. Okay, now let's look at section 4 of part 2. Let's look at inclining elements. And the mu function. And the trace formula, or the formula for the trace, in the Bernstein presentation. So yesterday we defined the trace in the Coxeter presentation, and that was a very simple object. Just the NWs all go to zero except the unit. But now we will express the same trace in the Bernstein presentation with the theta x. And then it turns out to be not so simple. But this will bring us very close to computing the explicit Poincaré formula. So we need the following intertwining elements. So if S is S alpha, with alpha in our base, I define RS, an element of the Hecke algebra. So it is VS times 1 minus theta minus 2 alpha MS minus VS minus 1 over VS plus Vs prime minus 1 over Vs prime theta minus alpha this is it. Then we satisfy this is an element in Lake Sumatra. These satisfy, first of all, the Brake relations for S in S0, as in the bio group, finite bio group. Second, if you commute them with the delta x, you just get the action of the bio group on the lattice, on the algebra A, the natural action. So this is a reformulation of the Bergstrand relation. And this is not exactly commuting, as I said. Well, you see, because the RS are not invertible. But in any case, you have this relation. And the non-invertibility will be clear by looking at the formula for the square. The square is a polynomial in the algebra A, the commutative algebra A. And that's closely related to the new function, so it's a very important thing for the Poincaré measure. So we have Vs squared, while denominator 2 alpha minus 2 alpha C alpha C minus alpha. And I have to tell you what these functions are. Let's see, so it's formula day today, I'm afraid, so C alpha is 1 plus theta minus alpha over Q alpha minus 1 minus theta minus alpha over Q alpha plus, divided by the Weyl denominator, and so this is just 1 minus theta 2 alpha, etc. And that's it. So here you see that in order to make these elements RS invertible, you have to invert these things that you get here in the algebra A. And so in fact, if you do that, then you see here that so the map from the bio group to the RS, or from the, you cannot say it like that, but so it defines in some sense a co-cycle of the bio group with values in the Hecken algebra. And you get as a result, following theory, or corollary of this, that which is not so, well, it's funny, but not important for us, but I just want to mention. So if I localize, so I make these elements invertible, the C alpha delta 2 alpha and the delta minus 2 alpha minus alpha, then this is isomorphic to simply the algebra A localized, and then the smash product with the finite bio. So it becomes certainly a very simple algebra in which you don't see the parameters anymore. And now we define the mu function. That's the rational function on the torus T. And it looks like this. So D. So this was from the normalization of tau. So remember, the tau of 1 was the dFV. So we had some rational function which we were dragging along. And this is important for later use to fit the Hecken algebras together. So it's d divided by the, this is basically q to the power the number of positive roots. This would be the expression if all the parameters are equal. And if they are not, then you have to write something complicated that I won't do. So you can assign a function from the finite Bayer group to monomials in the parameters. And here you apply it to the longest Bayer group element. And then there's one over the product over the positive groups. C alpha t, C alpha minus alpha t, sorry. And this is by definition 1 over this q of w0. And then, okay, this is just a mean item. C of t inverse. So the product of these positive c alphas gives you the c of t, and this one is c of t. Okay, so that's the rational function of t. And now, what is its meaning, or what is its role for the Poincaré formula? And that becomes clear somewhat by the following theory. So, let's take t in t v in the sense I just discussed. So this is the torus with calculus x over c, where the parameters q alpha plus minus are all in R plus. And okay, now I define some Fourier series in the algebra A. So the curly F E of T is a sum over the lattice, and then I take T minus X. So you see the torus T has character letters X, so this just means basically evaluating the character, so it would have been better to write X of T inverse, but I use that just as an equivalent. So it's just a Fourier series in this lattice, theta X. These are these Bernstein elements. And remember, the Bernstein elements are very simple when X is dominant. But because they are just in the Coxeter basis, they are just the MX for this translation subgroup. But if X is, for example, negative, then you have to invert these elements. And then it becomes something very horrible. Really, really horrible. But in any case, I'm summing this. And the claim is that this defines an element, this formal sum, in the dual of my Hecke algebra. If for all alpha simple groups, the real part of alpha t is less than Vs inverse. S is S alpha. So basically you should think of, so this is then the real, the vector part of this torus. So not the unitary part, but the vector part, which you can view as a vector space. And what this is saying is that in some sense, that if you take the shift in hyperplanes, alpha 1 is V1 inverse, alpha 2 is V2 inverse. So here is the domain of convergence for this series. And convergence here means just weak convergence in the dual. can view these elements theta x as elements in the dual because we have a natural bilinear form, right? So we have a natural bilinear form on H, namely x and y is the trace of x, y. And through that, I view these elements as elements in the dual of H. And so I can view this as a sum in the dual. And then there is the notion of weak convergence. It should give you a finite expression when you test it against any element of the finite Hilbert, of the Hilbert. And this is okay when we have this condition. And in fact, I can compute it. This thing turns out to be equal to the matrix coefficient of the minimal principal series with very precise properties. I will say that in a moment, times the mu function, which is a rational function. And this mu function has poles along these lines. So this is why you really need to stay in the negative sign. And so here, ET, so the map T to not curly, but the state ET is, this is an element in the dual. This is a regular family of matrix coefficients of the minimal principal series at T, such that, and there are two properties that I want you to remember. So the ET of the unit element is qw0 times our Weyl denominator, and ET of A HV is AT VT ET of H, where A and B are in the algebra A and H is in H. And well, if you look at this definition, then you see that if you integrate this Fourier series over a circle or over a compact torus, in principle you should get the unit element, right, of the Hecke algebra viewed as a function, which is exactly the trace. So here is the trace decomposition. It's a completely elementary thing, except for this transition from Bernstein basis to Coxeter basis, which you need in order to understand this convergence. So the statement is that, so this is a corollary, that the trace of the Hecke algebra can be written as an integral. So this is a unitary torus at V. And then this matrix coefficient Qw delta T. And then the mu function dt. And as I said, this is completely regular on the torus, as a family of functionals. And this guy is a rational function which has poles, for example, at these hyperplanes. But also, this will be a pole. So the game you will have to play is, you will have to move your contour. And here is T0, of course, should be in the domain of convergence. So the alpha of T0 should be the real part of it, and that should be smaller than V S alpha. So you are forced by the convergence to be here, but in order to, for example, go to the unitary tempered spectrum, you want to be here. And so you want to force this contour in that direction, but you need to pick up some residue. So there is a theory which is a lot of work, and I don't want to go into any details, but it states that you can refine this by doing some residue calculus. So you can rewrite this. In the following form, tau is equal to the integral over TV temp, and I will define all the ingredients of the formula just in a minute, and then the character chi t d mu t. And here, mu is the Poincaré measure, is the spectral measure of the trace restricted to the center of the hackout, which was the biomimic variance in A, which is a commutative thing. And remember, if you look at this kernel and you specialize to elements, so where H is 1 and V is 1, so elements from this algebra A, then this factor becomes 1. So this part is 1 on A. So this is some complication that completely disappears when you restrict to the center, which lies inside. And so then it's only integrating, it becomes, evaluation at T. On A. If I insert here an A in the algebra A, I just get AT. Because this normalization I wrote here shows that this denominator cancels against the value at 1, and this rule tells you that what you keep is only A of T. So here you see that the tau restricted to the algebra A is just integrating the A viewed as a function on the torus against this mu function. And this mu function is very beautiful and has very good properties. That's why you can do this residue calculus. So that's what you do first, and then you get a certain measure if you do all these residues. That's spectral measure mu. And the chi of t here is a tempered positive trace. So it is in fact a finite linear combination of tempered characters, irreducible characters, at central character W0T. So these are local, these are functionals on the Hecke algebra, but you can express them as a finite sum of characters, which all have this central character. So central characters, because the center is the biogroup invariance in A, are just the biogroup orbits in T. And if you look at this property, then it's clear that whatever you pick up at T, the central character, the orbit. And the fact that it is tempered follows from the residue calculus. That is a non-trivial fact. Because you can see that what you pick up satisfies the Kesselmann conditions for tempered. And then it's a finance, some is clear, because there are only finally many temporary characters around with a fixed central character. And so you it's not that hard. The hard part is the temperatures. Here, what is this set TV temp? Well, that is a union of what I call residual cosets. L residual coset in T of the tempered form of that residual coset. So that takes some explanation. So L in T is a coset of a subproduct. So we have just the notion of a connected subgroup of the torus, subtorus, and now you can move it by some element in the torus, then you get the coset of subtorus. So that's what I call coset. The residual is a very special condition. So it's called residual if the number of new poles pole hyperplanes alpha is q is plus or minus q alpha plus or minus. That is how the poles look. If you think back of this expression for the new function, that's where the pole hyperplanes were. So you can look at those pole hyperplanes which contain my coset L. So you count those and you subtract the number of the new zeros which contain L. And this should be equal to the codimension of L. So let me give two quick examples. So first is L is T. That's clearly a residual coset, the whole torus. Because the codimension is zero and both sets are zero. So that's clear. The second example is, and this corresponds in this spectrum to the unitary, the minimal principal series, the unitary minimal principles. And the second example is a point, namely we take R is, L is R0, singleton, where R0 is defined by, well, it's a point in the vector part of the torus. And the alpha of R0 is Q alpha plus for each simple root. So remember this picture. So it's this one. And there you see, it is a regular point. So there are no singularities. And all the simple roots give you a pole. And so you get exactly the length as many poles, which is exactly the codimension because it's a pole. So this is these are two extreme opposites, because this is the most continuous part of the spectrum and this is the point spectrum. But there are many more points in general. But this notion turns out to be very meaningful, as we will see in a minute. And then I have to tell you what is the residual part. I can maybe best write it as follows. So here we have such a coset. L, and here is the origin, then I take the perpendicular subtonus. This is what I call T lower one. And I take the subtonus which is underlying this coset. That I call T superscript one. And so I can have a root, there is a root system, sigma sub L, which is the roots, such that alpha restricted to L is constant. And so this is a Levy root system. In general, T lower L is the subtorus corresponding to the span of these Levy roots, the co-roots of them in the algebra of the torus. And T upper L is the identity component of the intersection of their kernels. And RL is the intersection point, but that's not completely well defined, because if you intersect two tora, you get the finite degree group with two of these transversal tora. So, but that's not a big deal. So I choose an element in L intersecting this T lower L. So that's a coset for a finite degree group. And then I put, whatever you choose, you will get the same outcome. Put L tempered is equal to RL is base as a base point, and then I take only the unitary part of my torus, T upper L, at the parameter V. And here the claim in this formula is that So the union over all those tempered parts of all those residual cosets is exactly equal to the support of our spectral decomposition. So now I want to formulate a little bit more precisely. So this is a parabolic induction. There's a theory on how to make this a little bit more precise, because this is really the basis for an explicit calculation of the Clausius measure. So first theory is the support theory. So the support, so that says that almost everywhere in this, what I indicated as the support, is indeed, if you're a non-zero case, that the chi of this T is a positive case. Based on this net algebra. So in particular, support of mu is indeed a union of this residual coset and the tempered part. And so if, and also if L is discrete, is a point, residual point, then this chi of R, so that's just this guy, is a finite sum of discrete series cavities. With central character, the orbit of this point. And also you can say a lot about the parabolic induction part. Make it quite explicit, so that L is
RL.
Up RL. Die zit op tossen. De T in L temp. Zo T kan ik even gaan rijden. Dat is een RL times T. Up RL. L temp in de genetic point. Genetic means that, well, it's a pole for the roots it has to be a pole for, and otherwise, with respect to all the other roots, it doesn't have any special relation. So, then we can say that so you have the Hecke algebra that contains the analog of the parabolic subalgebra associated with this Levy root system, which we take to be we take L such that the sigma such that delta L is a part of delta zero. So we take it standard in its standard position. Up to a bio group, actually we can do this. And then there is a Levy subalgebra. I think that Alan, by hearing what he was going to do tomorrow, he will say something about this type of induction. So this is sitting as a subalgebra, and then there is a quotient of semi-simple algebra. And that depends on the parameter that I choose in this center of the Hecke algebra ACL. I call this homomorphism phi to L. And so here, this is a Hecke algebra for a semi-simple root delta. Delta L, XL, delta L check. And then there are discrete series. So we take, so now we are going to induce those. So let's see what I'm writing here. So then, if we look at chi of t, it is the induced character from HL to H of the chi L RL. And this is a finite sum of discrete series characters with this homomorphism that depends on the induction parameter. And the chi L RL is a, as I said, is a finite sum of delta discrete series of this H lower L. The central character is the orbit W L R L. Certain constants. Times their character. And these constants are positive. Because it has to represent a positive place. But at the moment, we don't know much. And we will eventually have to compute them explicitly. But that's going to be the next stage. At this point, we are happy to know that they are constants. And then the measure nu is a sum of push forwards of measures supported on these residual parts, residual cosets. So nu L is a measure on L temp. And I can write it explicitly. has some DUL. T is again a constant, which is now known to be rational. And then this mu function of the sigma L root system and regularized at point RL, evaluated in RL, and then times the density function depending on T. And T, remember, is RL, T RL, and then DT RL. And I can give all these vectors explicit forms, so sigma L RL. RL is this dv over the q of w, the longest element in the Levi-Weyl group, and then times the product prime. The prime means omit all vectors equal to zero. And then we take the product over all the roots in sigma L, and then 1 plus alpha r inverse of minus alpha r inverse divided by 1 plus alpha r inverse divided by q alpha plus 1 minus alpha r. And this is an important function, so this expression I call m of sigma L with respect to the residue point r of v. And I view this as a rational function on my base space q, now attached to sigma L, the root system sigma L. And it is in fact is a regular function. On this real locus. It will have some singularities, but not on the real locus. And the density is very simple. So the density ML Ft is just the product of all the other roots which are not in the Levi-Weyl system. The part L, I call that 1 over the C functions. So I'm sorry for this, but this, I don't know how to tell you all this in a more clever way. So D. And an important property of these constants is this, that they are constants in the following sense. If I scale the parameters, we will see much more precise things later on. But for now, this is already an important result. V2S is V1S to some power epsilon, where epsilon is in R plus. So if you scale all the parameters simultaneously, then these constants are really constants. I mean, otherwise they might potentially depend on the parameters, but they don't. But this is a more difficult thing. So as a corollary of this, the spectral decomposition of the Hecke algebra reduces the classification of the distinct series at each orbit W0R, R residue point. And then the computation of their formal degree because the rest of the density is given by these formulas, and so the formal degree, that is what we now establish, is some constant times this n function. I just introduced it here relative to the Levy, but in general for the Hecke algebra itself, you also have distance series. I will not indicate the root system. And so this is a regular function on U, given by these formulas, which is now up to a constant. And also by the support theory, so every W0R orbit of residual point supports distance series. So now, if you allow me for just 2 minutes, because I want to say something that really makes maybe all these formulas worthwhile, otherwise I feel we are all hanging in the air. So there is one important fact that explains a little bit maybe what I'm trying to do. So it's the following theory. So if you define SL, so L is a residual coset. SL is the orbit of the tempered part of L modulo the viral group. Okay, so these are the components in the support, are the connected components of the support of the mesh of the partial measure. And in fact, So a famous example which I want to end with is the equal parameter case. So take the Vs is a V, some positive parameter for all the simple reflections equal. So then, and we take the lattice X is P. So then our Hecke algebra is the Iwamori Hecke algebra of a split adjoint group. And in that case, so we have this set that we just defined, the support, but in terms now of the root datum, so the orbits of these tempered forms of the residual cosets, which is the disjoint union of the SLs. And this set is in bijection with the set of unramified tempered Langlands parameters. So the set of G conjugacy classes of unramified tempered Langlands parameters for G. So if my group split the joint group G. And how does the map go? So if I have a Langlands parameter for my L group G check, then I map this to the viral group orbit of the image of this Frobenius tilde element. So let me recall, this was the Frobenius times this diagonal element in the SL2. So this is the phi of the Frobenius times the phi of V. Inverse 0,0. And well, so this, let's call this CL. and the five of the frobenius. So I choose here phi in its class such that this element is in the torus, which you can do because we are working with an adjoint group. And T is now the torus of D-check, which is a bit inconvenient. I'm sorry for that. I should have called that D-check, but it's too late now. And we can always twist by elements such that this lands in the torus, and then the phi of the Frobenius can be written as an element in the centralizer in G-check of the parameter intersected with my torus, or the unitary part of the torus. And this will give the shift to a vector in the vector group. And this I can write as, let's say, SL T upper L, the same T upper L as before. So this is in the T unitary upper L. And the SL CL is the RL of before. So this is the center of this residual coset that we attach to the parameter. So it will be an element of the phi of Frobenius Kilner. Let's see, this centralizer. So this will define the T upper L before. So this is an element now of RL T upper L unitary, which is the L tempered of a residual coset. So the point is, if you do this with an unidentified Lennard parameter, then the image will be a point in such a residual coset. And in fact, this is a bijection of Langlands parameters tempered with this union of these cosets. That's very remarkable, but it comes from the fact that this is really the way the Dynkin diagram of a unipotent element, or at least it contains this information. And so the U that Anne-Marie was talking about, you can retrieve from this information. So this shows that the support can be completely expressed in Langlands parameters, unidentified tempered Langlands parameters. And now it's a matter of checking, but I will complete it tomorrow, that in fact the conjecture of Hiraga, Ichino, and Ikeda for the Iwahori spherical case holds, at least up to constants. These constants that we didn't yet compute, but up to these constants, and remember the converse statement was also true up to the constants. So it's already quite an achievement. But computing the constants requires different techniques. Okay, thank you. Supposed to be the weighted Dynkin diagram. If you take V equal to, so you should take basically then the derivative of phi and then take the image of the canonical element 1 minus 1, 0, 0. But that gives you the weighted Dynkin diagram of a distinguished nilpotent element in the centralizer of the Langlands parameter, which is a latent. At least a connected component. And now it turns out that these things are in bijection with the residual points. And now I want you to think back of this example of the residual point I gave you that was given by saying that all the simple roots have a pole. And that the weighted Dynkin diagram for that is giving just the value 2 to every root. So it corresponds to the regular orbit. But if you do this, if you think of what it means to be in a general point, and you have this condition of the number of poles minus the number of zeros, that comes from the residue calculus. But that is exactly the same condition for when a parabolic is a distinguished parabolic. Because you have to have that the dimension of G0 in this filtration is the dimension of G2. It's exactly saying this this equality. So you see on the nose that the classification is a classification of the same offense.
More questions?